Greetings all who are watching the video. Today I will be discussing with you or sharing with you about the suffering. It's not just the suffering, but it's the suffering for Christ, suffering because of Christ. Remember, there's a book that says, we are fools for Christ's sake. Just for the sake of Christ, we are fools. Before those who think they are wise, we are fools. But we know that we are not fools. In deep, in the heart, we know that we are not fools. For the Bible again says, for the heart knows its bitterness. So before I can go further with the word, I would like us to pray just a short prayer. This prayer, I have a point in it, and you must just listen to this point and believe in it. And that prayer, I will explain to you what is the point after. Let us just close our eyes. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that you be with us. Amen. In this prayer, you should believe. I tell you something, you can pray for 19 hours without stopping, but if you don't believe, there's nothing indeed. That's just the waste of time. You can pray for many hours. You can pray on the streets, on the trains, on wherever you want to go. But if you don't believe, you are just wasting your time. You wasted your time, actually. You can pray for a little period and believe you have done great. For you believe, we will share about belief next time. Now it's about the suffering for Christ. The first scripture will open, it's Mark 6, verse 14. Here it is. It says, King Herod heard of it, for Jesus' name had become known. Some said, John the Baptist has been raised from the dead. That is why these miraculous powers are at work in him. But others said, he is Elijah. And others said, he is a prophet like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, just listen to this, whom I beheaded, why? He was beheaded just because of Christ. For the sake of Christ, John was beheaded. His head was taken off for following the word of Christ, for following Christ. So if you too, you follow Christ, something will happen to you, but do not worry when that happens. Know that eternal life is coming. Eternal life is close to you. Eternal life is life after death. I don't mean any death, but the fleshly death. For there are two types of deaths, the spiritual death and the physical death. In the physical death, that's when you just die physically and we bury you and you go back to the dust. As according to the book of Ecclesiastes 3, verse 20, that says, all are from the dust and all shall return to dust, but only the spirit of man shall return from where it came from. So before I can go further with other topics, let me go further with this one. I will read 2 Corinthians 11 from verse 22. From verse 22, it says, are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they offspring of Abraham? So am I. Are they servants of Christ? I am better one. I am talking like a madman. With far greater labor, far more imprisonment, with countless beatings, and often near death. This was Saul, or I can say Paul, because his name was changed from Saul to Paul. Paul here is talking about the way he was persecuted, the way he was beaten, the way he suffered just for the sake of the name of Christ. If you preach on the way, on the street and say, oh, Christ is life, people will even want to kill you, but go there and say, I have 100 million here. Who wants to join me? They will run after you, up until their legs will get hit with sweat. Another scripture will open, 2 Timothy 3. It will be from verse 12. This scripture is so nice. I like it. You should learn it in life. You should know that in life, this scripture does take us. It is 2 Timothy 3 verse 12. It says, indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Meaning, everyone, even you at home, even you, wherever you're watching, if you want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus, you will suffer persecutions. Remember, for you to be in the state that Christ was in, for you to be in the position that Christ was in, dying for nations, being nailed on the cross just for the sake of other people. Just imagine about that. For you, if you want to be like anyone who is living godliness in a godly life in Christ, you will suffer persecution. Just like in school, you will never go to school and say, I did not learn. No, you will never live a godly life in Christ and say, I was never persecuted. That life is not yet there. I tell you, if you are in Christ, there will be a point where you will say, no, I'm leaving church. No, I'm leaving this. That is the test. That is the devil test tempting you sometimes. And it is the God testing you. For the devil tempt, but the God of hosts tests. I will read again the book of 2 Corinthians 10 from verse 3. This will be almost the last scripture. I like the scriptures a lot. It is 2 Corinthians 10 from verse 3. Okay, here it is. It says, for though we walk in the flesh, and we are not waging war according to flesh, for the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. This, if you understand very well, it is talking about the life in flesh and the life in spirit. Read the whole book, you will understand that. But what I want to pick in a point is that we do not fight against our persecutors, but we are fighting a spiritual fight. Remember, when you go to Christ, the devil will want to win you from Christ. The devil doesn't care about those who are in the world, because he is already done with them. To him, they are just ends. He can step all over them any time he wants. But when you are in Christ, you are like a needle. Once he steps on you, he will get hurt. The last scripture is 2 Corinthians 4. I like this book of Corinthians. 2 Corinthians 4 from verse 8. It says, we are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed. In Christ, John was beheaded. Physically, they thought they were finished with him, but they don't know that they brought him to life. Now he is in eternal life. They brought him to death, physically. We do not care about the flesh. Remember, we are not fighting against the flesh, but the spirit. So what we care is that, where will our spirit go? Will it go to hell, which is the second death, or will it go to heaven, which is the eternal life? Where will it go? Where will your spirit go? Remember, I should tell you this in my conclusion, that you should repent, actually, for the kingdom of God is near. These are the words of John the Baptist, the one they beheaded. When he was getting out of the wilderness to complete his ministry, he said, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent. Act over. Change. Change from your evil ways to your good ways. Wherever you are, when you get time, just go to the scripture of Ezekiel 18, the whole of it, and Ezekiel 3 verse 18. Those scriptures are so nice. They talk about changing. But if you change now and you die tomorrow, what will be looked at is what you did good the last time. You can be good for the rest of your life, but then the last time you kill a person, then that means there's a big chance for you to go to hell, even though you were good. So be constant in prayer, never change. Another thing in Revelation, it says, it's in Revelation, actually let me read it. It's in Revelation 3 verse 11. That scripture is so nice too. I like it. I like to share about it. The scripture is in Revelation 3 from verse 11. It says, I am coming soon. Hold fast what you have, so that no one may seize your crown. Meaning, hold on what you take on your righteousness that no one may take account from heaven. The last message is that when we are in church, some people don't go to church and say, church is useless. Let me tell you something. When you are not in church and you are just in the world, you are just like in a forest. Actually, you are just like in a desert. That's when the devil can get you very much. Nice. Just imagine if you are in a war and you are in a desert. There's no way to hide. There's no way to run to. They will just kill you. But if you are in church, it doesn't mean that problems will not come. They will come. Because problems, they are the ones that build us. Problems, they are the ones that exalt us. Problems, by them, we are famous. By them, we are successful. By problems, by matters. When you are in church, I tell you, you are in a forest, in a wall. You can hide in a tree and not get shot. But when you are not in church, you are in a desert. Thank you, wherever you are. Thank you.